Without further ado, I think that we should introduce our keynote speaker, Simon Willison.
Absolutely. Welcome, Simon.
Hi, it's great to be here.
I'm so glad you're here. Okay, so for those of you who don't know Simon, he's the co-creator of Django. He's the creator of Datasette, which you'll hear a bit more about today. I've been following Simon for years on Twitter. Simon does a lot of his work in public, which means that people like me can learn from his successes, his failures, his learnings. I've learned so much from you, Simon, these last couple of years.
I got to tell you, I lost several hours the other day after the first path to Citus Con, no doubt reading his Things I Learned blog, which is kind of like a micro blog of sorts. It was fantastic and, you know, just sort of reminded me I should really get back to doing more blogging. It's really good stuff.
Yes, I should point out that Simon was a guest on the first episode of Path to Citus Con, which is this live audio show on Discord, kind of like a podcast, but with text chat. And we talked about working in public, which is a whole fascinating conversation in and of itself. But you're here to talk about big opportunities and small data. So without further ado, I think we should pass the floor to you. You've got the stage, Simon.
Fantastic. So yeah, today I want to talk about small data. And the reason I'm talking about that here is I feel like as an industry, we've got big data pretty much figured out at this point. You know, you've got tools like Citus that let you horizontally scale your Postgres database. It feels like every data warehouse product out there that I care about is adding Postgres protocol support and so forth. Like, we know what to do if somebody has petabytes of data now. That's not a difficult problem for us to solve. But I'm really interested in the very other end of the scale. The last 5 years, I've been exploring the issue of small data, where I define small as too big for Excel, but small enough that it fits on a thumb drive or fits on your telephone. My telephone's got a half terabyte of space on it right now, so small data can get pretty big. And the way I've been exploring that is through an open source project that I've been working on called Datasette. And I'm actually going, rather than talk about what Datasette is, I'm going to dive straight into a demo and show you what it is and what it can do and how it works. This right here is the City of San Francisco's Open Data Portal. And this is a trend from the past decade, which I'm very excited about, where local and national governments all around the world have been launching these data portals where they publish data about the places where people live. And some of these things are updated on a daily basis. Like, it's really interesting seeing quite how much information is flowing through all of these things. The problem, of course, is that just because you published data doesn't mean that people can actually use it. And so in this case, I'm going to do a demo using the City of San Francisco's city facilities data. And this is definitely small data. It's 1,700 rows, right? It's absolutely tiny. And what I can do is I can copy and paste that URL, and I'm going to load it into Datasette. Datasette is a Python web application. It supports plugins, which are similar to Postgres extensions. And I've got plugins installed here for things like load data from an open data portal. So I'm going to fire this up here and paste in that URL I just pasted, hit that button, and Datasette will go and fetch that data and extract things like the metadata around it, so what the columns are. And it'll also pull in that table of 1,700 rows. Now, tables not particularly exciting, but one of the Datasette plugins I'm running is it's called Datasette Cluster Map, and it looks for data with a longitude and latitude column and sticks that data on a map. So now I can click I can click Load All down at the bottom, and now I've got all 1,700 facilities loaded onto this map. And already we're starting to see stories in the data. Like, why does the city of San Francisco have 21 buildings down here? It turns out this is a juvenile detention facility that the city owns and operates down in La Honda. If you scroll to the side, you'll see that there are things like these. This is infrastructure for the Hetch Hetchy reservoir. This is a Hetch Hetchy substation. And then over here, we've got another cluster of markers, which is it's a camp. This is a camp operated by the Parks and Recreation Department. An important feature of Datasette is what I call faceting. It's essentially a group by and count. So I can say, you know what, let's facet by city. and see that most of them are in San Francisco, but you've got some in La Honda, some in Groveland. We're going to facet by jurisdiction. Now, this is telling us which jurisdictions within the San Francisco government own the most property. And Parks and Recreation are top. Port is 213. The airport's quite big, the school district. But so just with a few clicks, with importing that data into a new tool, we're already starting to learn things about the data at a sort of aggregate level. And this is something I'm really passionate about, this idea that you can take data from an open data portal in basically any shape or size and quickly start diving into it and figuring out, okay, what are the interesting trends and patterns? What does this look like if we visualize it? Another feature of Datasette I should demonstrate quickly is all of this is running on top of a SQL database. So when I filter by 38 for public health and then 37 in San Francisco, that's building up a SQL WHERE query for me. When I click View and Edit SQL, it actually shows me that SQL query, and it lets me edit it. So I can say, you know what, I don't need any of this stuff. I'm going to keep the rest in there. I can hit Run SQL, and now I'm getting back just the results of that particular query. And that's bookmarkable. I can copy and paste this URL and send it to somebody else, and they will see that same query that I'm seeing. Even more importantly, you can get it back out as CSV, or you can get it out as JSON. And this means that Datasette can serve as an integration layer for anything that can speak JSON, which is effectively everything these days. So there's a lot of power in being able to run these arbitrary queries against a read-only database that's safe. There's nothing, no damage that you can do with this. But it gives you a very flexible and powerful way of remixing data and exporting it out and doing interesting things with it afterwards. We'll switch back to the slides. And where's my slide control gone? Sorry about this. There we are. So the reason I got interested in this in the first place was I started out actually in the realm of data journalism. So I worked for the Guardian newspaper in London, and we realized that our journalists were collecting all sorts of fascinating facts about the world in order to create infographics and maps for the newspaper. And every time this happened, they'd collect all of this data, and then it would sit on a hard drive under somebody's desk. And we decided that we'd start sharing that data with the wider world, try and publish the data behind the stories anytime we put out one of these infographics. So we started a thing called the Data Blog, and it was a blog of data that we had collected to support the reporting that we were doing. And at the time, we ended up using Google Sheets as the mechanism for publishing the data, because it was free and it already existed, and we didn't have to build anything custom. But it always frustrated me. I always felt like there should be a better way of publishing data, something that was open source and more powerful and more flexible. And the question I asked myself was, what's the best possible way of publishing this structured data? And that's where the idea for Datasette came from. Datasette was basically my attempt at answering that question about the best possible way of publishing data that let people both explore it and also do integrations and automate it and things like that. I hinted at this a moment ago, this idea of being able to do read-only SQL queries via an API, which I find amusing because for most web applications, this would be considered a SQL injection attack. This is a security hole that you must be prevented at all costs. With Datasette, it's a documented feature. And I get away with that because Datasette it treats data as read-only, so you can't damage it. It sets a time limit on the queries, so you can't go too long with them. And it gives you that API access so that you can do interesting things on top of it. I'll show you a problem that I solved with this just the other day. This is my blog. I've been blogging for nearly 21 years about all manner of different topics. I've got a tag cloud, which goes on forever with all of the different things that I've written about. But I decided that it's 2023. The cutting edge of publication right now is an email newsletter. Like, email newsletters are very much back again. And I wanted to start doing that, but I didn't want to have to do any additional work for it. So since I've got this data in a database and I've got a Datasette instance that gives me the ability to query my own blog, I figured I'd try and automate the process of constructing that newsletter. So I built this utterly terrifying SQL query, which pulls from all of my different content types and arranges them together into a format like this. And then I built this observable notebook. If you haven't played with observable yet, it's a really interesting tool. It's basically kind of like Jupyter notebooks for Python, but in JavaScript. And it makes it very easy to build custom applications that pull in data from different sources, remix it and reformat it in different ways. And so what I did is I took that terrifying SQL query, I dropped it into the notebook right here. Where's my skipped implementation? So I dropped that in, I wrote a bunch of JavaScript to glue it together into HTML and all of that sort of stuff. And then I had it output the HTML for my newsletter. And actually that's, I can click this to get rid of the things I've already sent out. So right now, if I was to send a newsletter, it would have this content in. And I added a button that copies and pastes it to the clipboard. So now I can pop into Substack and hit paste, and my newsletter is ready to send. This is also kind of a hack against Substack, because Substack don't offer an API. There was no official automated way to create content for Substack. But it turns out copy and paste is kind of the universal integration method. I've done quite a few things where something doesn't have an API, but if you fiddle around with copy and paste just enough, you can actually do a lot of automation on top of it. So a sort of key hack here is to abuse Substack's ability to paste content to automate the creation of this. And this works. Now I've got Simon Willison's Substack newsletter. You can subscribe to it. I send it out once or twice a week. And it's been working out pretty well. I've been running it for a month and it's picked up a bunch of subscribers. And it's been almost no work. I probably spent a lot more time fiddling with my notebook than I did actually like writing any custom content for that newsletter. And that's really that really goes to illustrate how useful it is to have data with an API that speaks SQL, right? SQL is a very powerful sort of domain-specific language for remixing and combining data. And some people use things like GraphQL to give themselves an API for manipulating data in custom ways. SQL's GraphQL from the 70s, right? It's worked for a very long time. It's a very robust way of doing these sort of semi-safe custom integrations. And I think there's a huge amount of power just in using SQL like that, making things bookmarkable, giving things JSON endpoints that accept SQL. There's a lot of really cool stuff that you can do with that. But crucially, Datasette is not built on top of Postgres. The database that I'm using under the hood for all of this is SQLite. It's my second favorite database after Postgres. And there are a few different reasons that I'm using SQLite for this. SQLite claims to be one of the most widely installed pieces of software in the world and absolutely the most widely deployed database engine. It's in every iPhone, every Android phone. I'm pretty sure it's running on my Apple Watch and counting my steps, because SQLite is designed as an embedded library. It's a very, very small, very tightly written C library that you can drop into literally anything on any platform, and it gives you the full power of a relational database. A crucial characteristic is that a SQLite database is just a file. It's a data.db file that sits there on your disk, and this makes them super easy to work with. You can back them up by creating a copy. You can share them by emailing them to people. Creating a new file is as expensive as creating any file on disk. If you've lost interest in it, you can just throw it away again. So it's a very quick and agile way of working with data. But despite the fact that it's so sort of like tiny and flexible, it's also a very stable file format. The Library of Congress lists SQLite as one of their approved archival mechanisms for structured data. And that's because the SQLite team are meticulous about not breaking backwards compatibility when they release new versions. So once your data is in SQLite, it's going to basically be safe forever as something that you can then query and use in the future. And that's as somebody who cares about newspapers, that's a really big deal. And then the other idea that Datasette illustrates, which came from inspired me to use SQLite, is something that I call the baked data architectural pattern. These days, deploying a web application has never been cheaper in terms of running that web application somewhere in the cloud. You've got technology like Kubernetes and Docker. Then there are hosting providers like AWS Lambda or Google Cloud Run or Vercel or Fly, who will all run a stateless web application for cents a month if it's not getting much traffic. They're incredibly inexpensive. There is a catch, and the catch is that you can't run a database in them, because the reason these things are so cheap is that they're essentially read-only stateless web applications that you don't get to write to a disk. Or if you do write to a disk, it doesn't get persisted anywhere, which makes them very cheap and inexpensive to run. But if you want to run a relational database, you're kind of out of luck. You have to pay a lot of extra money for a hosted database somewhere. The thing I realized is that if your data is read-only, none of this matters. Like, once you start dealing with read-only data, and in my case, it's SQLite database files, it's literally a blob of bytes on a disk. If it's read-only, the fact that you can't write back to the disk again isn't actually an issue. And for the world that I care about, coming from things like journalism, a lot of the data sets that we're dealing with don't ever get updated. You know, it's a snapshot of San Francisco city facilities that might be updated a few times a month, but it's not something that's going to accept constant writes. So when you've got a read-only database, there's a trick you can pull where you can effectively bundle that database up as part of the application that you're deploying onto these platforms. And now you can deploy a fully capable relational database interface that costs you a few cents a month in hosting costs. A lot of these platforms have a feature called scale to zero, which means if there's no traffic coming into your application, it doesn't cost you any money at all. The application is essentially static. Then they start the thing up running when the first HTTP request comes in. And when you've got scale to zero, it means that your costs for these sort of low traffic projects are effectively nothing. I think many of these providers here have a free tier, and it's very common for projects that get little traffic to fit entirely within that tier. So effectively, we have free hosting for these applications if you can get away with just having read-only data. And the flip side of that is that they scale up really well as well. If you want to serve millions of requests a second using this baked data pattern, you can do that by running multiple copies. Spin up as many copies of the entire application and a full copy of the database in each one, stick them behind a load balancer, and you can handle as much traffic as you can throw at it. Which again, for journalism, when you have things like election results days and so forth, this is a really useful ability as well. I touched on this a little bit, but I want to dive a bit more into the fact that SQL plus HTTP is a fantastic integration tool. And I'll show you another example of a project that I run. This is a website called niche-museums.com. And it's the website I run for my main hobby, which is seeking out and exploring tiny museums. The idea behind this is, if you go to a big museum, sure, it'll be interesting. If you go to a really small museum, it doesn't matter what it's about. The chances are that the person who is at the desk at that museum is the person who set it up. So now you get to have a conversation with somebody who collects Pez dispensers or runs the Bigfoot Discovery Museum. Or in this case, this is the Misalignment Museum in San Francisco, which tells the story of it's an apology from AI for destroying humanity in the future. It's only open for a few more weeks, so it's worth popping in if you're in the area. But anyway, this website is actually just Datasette. This is my Datasette web application with a custom index.html template so that it looks like a website. And all of the features on this, like use my location and search and the atom feed up here, those are all just SQL queries that are baked into Datasette. This right here is the query for the atom feed. And If we highlight these options here, you can see that the way this works is it selects things and it aliases them as atom ID, atom title, atom updated, atom link. Then there's a dataset plugin called dataset atom, which looks for those column names. And if it finds them, it produces a link to an atom feed. So this single SQL query here defines the atom feed for the website purely by reshaping the data in SQL to that specific set of columns. That terrifying coalesce chunk at the bottom is showing how in depth you can get with this if you want to construct, in this case, the HTML for the blog entry. And this works, right? This is NetNewsWire, the feed reader, subscribed to the feed of content from my Niche Museums website. So there's a lot of different moving parts involved here, but fundamentally, I've used a SQL query to transform data from whatever format it's stored in that website into a format that's compatible with feed readers. And then they've got a little plugin that turns that into XML. So the baked data pattern, I've done a lot of exploration of this using SQLite. A open question for me is, could you do this with Postgres itself? I'm very confident that this would work. I think there's no reason at all you couldn't put together a Docker container that contains a full installation of Postgres with data volumes and all of the stuff that Postgres needs to serve a read-only database, bundle that up with an application like a Django app or something on top, and deploy the entire thing in exactly the same way as I'm doing with SQLite. And this would give you all of those same benefits. You could get a scale to zero thing where your website costs nothing nothing at all if nobody's visiting it. You could scale it to handle a million requests a second if you need to, just by deploying multiple copies of that same thing. So I think there's something very interesting that could be explored around this, and many other databases as well. Elasticsearch, for example, is something that you could absolutely bake into a container with its index data and get, you know, a very powerful search feature that costs you nothing at all if nobody's using that particular application. I've got one last demo. This, again, very much fits the theme of small data. It turns out you can run things like Datasette entirely in your browser these days, thanks to WebAssembly. So I'm going to switch over to my demo again and show you a thing that I built called Datasette Lite. Could we switch to the demo feed? My fault. My screen sharing stopped. I'll just fix that now. Window. Here we go. Okay, we should be, there we go. So Datasette Lite is Datasette running entirely in WebAssembly. So I've opened up the network pane here so you can see what it does. In the left-hand side, it's loading up Datasette and installing packages and so forth. On the right-hand side, you can see it downloaded something called pyodide.asm.js. That's and pyodide.asm.data. This is a full Python interpreter and the Python standard library bundled up for WebAssembly so that it runs in the browser. So right here, I have a server-side web application, like Datasette is a traditional server-side app that's running entirely client-side, and most of the functionality is working. I can facet, and I can run SQL queries and all of those kinds of things. And I built this actually as a joke. I thought it would be amusing to show that a server-side web app can run client-side now, but I didn't think it would be useful for anything. But since I built it, I found that I'm using it for all sorts of different purposes, mainly because it's 100% robust, right? There is no server. This is all just HTML and JavaScript. There is nothing that can break with this, which means that I can build things on it and share them with people and not have to worry about hosting bills or the thing might break in 10 years' time or anything like that. So just yesterday, a project called Red Pajama released a training data set for building ChatGPT-style language models. They released it. It's 1.2 trillion tokens. And this is how they released it. It's a file called urls.txt with 2,048 URLs in it. Each of these is like a gigabyte large file, which you can then download. And to gather all of this stuff, to download all of it, you'd need 2.7 terabytes of disk space. I do not have 2.7 terabytes of disk space, but I still wanted to get a feel for this data. So I wrote a little Python script that did a head request against each URL to get back just the length of that file. And I turned that into a JSON array. So here we go. This is saying that file there is this big, and I've got megabytes and gigabytes as well. And its top folders are these. Very, very simple. And what I can do now is I can click load JSON in Datasette Lite, paste that URL in, and it'll import that JSON document and turn it into a table. So now I can start answering questions like, what are the top folders? It turns out that Wikipedia, there's only one file. I think if I sort by size, I can see that Wikipedia is the largest file. They have a 111 gigabyte file you can download with all of English Wikipedia in. But this project here took me 5 minutes to knock together. I've got an article about it on my blog. I literally did the whole thing, copied and pasted it into a gist, assembled this, and then started sending people this link. So, you know, running a database in WebAssembly is actually a really interesting trick. Excitingly, you can do this with Postgres as well. This right here is a project that Crunchy Data built to provide an interactive tutorial for learning SQL. And this is a full Postgres running in your browser. This was actually inspired by my work on Datasette Lite. There's one catch. It's a 50 megabyte download to get this working because they ended up having to do a full virtualized Linux operating system with Postgres running on top in order to build this. I'm very confident that with a lot of extra work, you could shrink this down and just run Postgres itself. And that brings me to could we switch back to the slides? And so the reason I use SQLite for so many of my projects is that SQLite is a genuinely serverless browser database. It doesn't need a server. And this is the original meaning of serverless before it meant whatever it means today in the cloud. There is no server. SQLite, it's a file on disk. It's a C library that opens that file. everything is done without network connections. And that's really powerful and useful and something I'm seeing more of these days as well. DuckDB has become popular over the past few years, and it's exactly the same idea as SQLite. It's a library you can install, and then you can do it. It gives you columnar sort of analytical database. So like SQLite, but optimized for those analytical queries. And it's really cool. It's a very exciting piece of software. My question is, could Postgres do the same thing? What if there was a sort of a bundled version of Postgres that existed without the network stack, without the sort of server side of it, but it gave you access to the core Postgres, core Postgres SQL and data structures and so forth in a way that meant that me as a Python programmer could pip install it? I would love to be able to say pip install Postgres lib or npm install or whatever, import it into my Python code, and then use it like I do SQLite and DuckDB today. This would give me the best of all worlds. It would give me the feature I care most about from SQLite, but it would also give me Postgres's far richer and far more feature complete version of SQL. And it would give me access to PostGIS and extensions like that as well. So this is kind of my dream. I think this is, if this happened, I would drop SQLite in a heartbeat and I would be able to build all of my stuff in Postgres again. So the idea is to take away. Small data is really cool. It deserves more tooling. It's worth thinking about how you can build tools for the small end as well as for the big end of the scale. The baked data pattern is a way of scaling read-only data both up and down, which I think is really powerful and gives you a lot of options for interesting deployment strategies. Read-only SQL APIs are a great idea. Forget about SQL injection. It's fine. Just put, if it's public data, let people SQL inject all that they like. And yeah, you can run databases in the browser now. I never thought I'd see the day. And if you're looking for a very complicated side project, please build me Postgres as a library. I would really appreciate that. And yeah, that's all I've got for you today. I will be on Discord for the rest of the conference and very keen on talking about this. And yeah, I've got time for questions.
Awesome. There's a number of different things I loved about that. Somebody mentioned in the Discord about the original start with looking at Datasette and how it really opens things up to, you know, the idea of like, let's go explore the data, not like, here's some pre-compiled thing that you should look at in this data. It really is about exploring it, which I think is really fantastic. So that was pretty interesting. And now I feel like there's a bit of a call to arms. I sort of wanted to ask a little bit about how you integrate this with Postgres. How much have you looked at that? And I see that you've kind of got some call to arms in there on like, well, here's what you could do with more Postgres in there.
So I've actually built that a little bit. A couple of years ago, I built this thing called Django SQL Dashboard, where the idea, because I had a Django app that I wanted to do dataset-like things against. And so this is a little Django application I built, which works against a read-only Postgres thing and gives you some of that dataset functionality. The longer term, I would love dataset to have pluggable backends. If dataset could talk directly to Postgres, I think that would be phenomenal. And I've shied away from doing that because then I have to build every feature for SQLite and for Postgres. But I'm beginning to grow a hunch that that's not as difficult as I thought it would be. The SQL dialects are very similar between the two. So it might happen.
Yeah, absolutely. I've had the opportunity to talk to Richard Hip from SQLite a number of times, and he's always stated that he looks at the Postgres, you know, syntax and language as sort of a first implementation for him to base what he does. So I think that would actually be pretty easy to make that all put together. So sounds awesome.
What I like about your talk, Simon, is just that you're looking at Postgres from right next door, right? You're not actively spending all of your days working on Postgres, but you are solving similar sorts of problems with other tools. And I think you and I talked about this as a Postgres adjacent talk.
Absolutely.
When we were first conceptualizing it. And I think it's great because you see things in a way that's different from those of us who are like in this circle all the time. So
I would actually love to chat more. I think we are
Discord.
Question for time. Yeah. So there are questions in the Discord. I will be checking that out as well. But I think we actually need to move on to our next speaker. Sadly,
Simon, thank you so much for being
absolutely.
Here.
Absolutely. 100%. That was awesome.
Thanks very much for having me. And yeah, I'll be on Discord in just a few seconds.
And thank you for your Path to Citus Con episode one, which I hope people catch. Really, really interesting conversation on working in public too. Cool. Have a great day.